As an anime watcher and manga reader, I tend to discover a lot of shows and books through various outlets. For Shinsekai Yori, it was Spotify recommending it to me via the ending theme Wareda Ringo on a radio. For Asobi Asobase, it was the countless clips I saw on Reddit. And for Land of the Lustrous, it was from watching very similar content to the videos I make today on YouTube. But much like any show you get recommended, it gets placed in the depths of your watch list only to be picked up months, maybe years down the line, or sometimes just straight up removed. So I'm going to say this once and only once because I'm a bit unbalanced standing on this soapbox. Watch Land of the Lustrous as soon as you can, because when I finally came around to watching it, I was blown away by how this unique piece of media managed to captivate me much more than I anticipated. Hello all viewers of Japanese hand-drawn media, my name is Nyanachi, and here's your introduction to Hoseki no Kuni, better known as Land of the Lustrous. Land of the Lustrous starts off in an Earth-like landscape where the flow of time seems to be much less important to the creatures who inhabit it than it is to us. That is, because the main protagonists of our story aren't even human. The main cast resemble humans quite a bit, but are entirely composed of gems and are practically immortal. Because if they shatter, they can just be placed right back together so long as you have all the pieces. You learn within the first episode that the current Earth, as we know it, had previously been struck 6 times by meteors, creating 6 moons corresponding to each strike. This destroyed the living landscape creatures inhabited and left only a single coast behind. Once the land was no longer livable, all living creatures escaped to the ocean, and the specific creatures that once flourished during the time of a single moon sank to the bottom of the ocean, where they eventually got consumed by microscopic organisms and were reborn as inorganic substances which washed up on the shore and became the gems. Each gem is composed of microscopic organisms called inclusions that feed off of light and allow them to move. The gemstones that make up their bodies carry the memories of each gem, which means the more pieces of their body that break off, the more memories they lose. Each gem's durability and frequency of shatters relies upon their position on the Mohs scale of hardness. Those well below 5 will shatter more frequently and have a hard time lifting heavy objects, while those much above 5 almost never break, unless immense force is applied. The gems are enrolled in a school and instructed by their sensei, who makes them fight a mysterious group of enemies that descend from the moon, known as the Lunarians. Not much is known about the Lunarians other than the fact that they steal gems, are composed of a gaseous substance, only appear during the day, and have some sort of relationship to Sensei. If the gems can slice them in two, the Lunarians are pretty easy to defeat and dissipate into thin air, but that hasn't stopped them from stealing countless gems over the years, all of which have never returned home. Neat, right? Well, that's only the beginning. As the gems fight more Lunarians and uncover more lore, the plot takes an interesting turn, to say the least. But I won't spoil that for you quite yet. Let's talk characters. Land of the Lustrous follows the life of Phosphophyllite, the shy, annoying, and utterly useless, gorgeous green gem that registers at a whopping 3.5 on the Mohs hardness scale. Phos pretty much shatters into a million pieces if you so much as even think about touching her, so she was never given a job by Sensei, unlike the other gems. That is, until she's given the task of creating an encyclopedia to document the current world around her. Phos wants to battle the Lunarians, but wouldn't be fit for the job as she's too fragile to do so. So most of her time in the early part of the story is spent moping around, complaining about the boring job she was given, and getting herself in as much trouble as she possibly can, and yes, shattering a lot in the process. Phos and the other gem's instructor, Kongo Sensei, who they just call Sensei, is a kind and understanding person who tries his hardest to keep Phos out of trouble. Not much is known about him, including details regarding whether he's even a gem or not. But he saves the gems if they're in danger, and gives each and every one of them a role to fulfill, aside from their battles against the Lunarians. Speaking of gems, here's a few who appear the most frequent. You have Bort, the hardest gem with an obsession on battling, Diamond, the sparkly gem who is also skilled but relies too much on Bort, Yellow Diamond, the eldest but not the wisest of the gems, Rutile, the quack doctor with a big attitude, Cinnabar, the loner who secretes venom and is more fragile than foes, Jade, the more reasonable, serious gem of the bunch, Ghost Quartz, the librarian who has a second gem inside of her, and Lex, the Lunarian fanatic who can't even look at them without getting enraged. You get to know them through their various interactions with foes, and the battles they endure throughout the story. You also get to see more from the Lunarians and a third species later in the manga, but I won't spoil that until later in this video. So let's discuss world building instead. Phosphophyllite starts the story with a clipboard and a notepad, but never even writes on it once. However, that doesn't mean she never discovers anything new, but rather she's just bad at her job. Or is she? She may not write the encyclopedia, but she certainly discovers enough to make one. The world of Land of the Lustrous is given to you in bite-sized pieces rather than a whole plot dump later down the line. What Foes sees for the first time is what you see for the first time as well. This means that while you're thrown into a confusing landscape with no explanation at all, you're actually able to learn and absorb the information for yourself. With each situation Foes gets stuck in, you start to piece together the world around you as she does the same. She's constantly searching for some sort of truth in a universe that's eager to turn her away. The world is full of well-kept secrets and roadblocks just waiting to throw you off. Ichikawa will let you learn that something is the way it is, and then in an instant turn on you and tell you it's actually different. Instances such as gems discovering and battling new forms of Lunarians and foes discussing unknown lore with creatures that you didn't even know existed keep you curious and engaged throughout the whole series. Not to mention the impressive detailed landscape that surrounds the gems. From the cliffs of the shore of Nascency to the ice floes during winter to even the landscape under the ocean, this sprawling undiscovered world strikes your curiosity in just the right way. It draws you in and leaves you helplessly engaged. That is Land of the Lustrous. If you feel like this is a show that appeals to you, I highly recommend stopping the video now, as I will dive into a bit of spoiler territory at this point. Land of the Lustrous is written by Haruko Ichikawa and currently has 10 published volumes licensed by Kodansha Comics in America, with volume 11 being released in late August. The 2017 anime adaptation was done by Studio Orange, who are well known for their renowned work on the Beastars anime. It covers a little over 4 volumes of material and has an incredible music score to go along with it. Both are worth checking out, and both are worth experiencing blind. You have been warned. What I really enjoy about Land of the Lustrous is the way they develop Phosphophyllite, the main character, and how you always retain mixed feelings about her. Foes starts off very innocent and clumsy in nature, and pretty blank slate as far as characters go. But blank slate isn't always the worst choice to make a character so long as you give them an appropriate personality. Since the beginning, you notice how her actions seem to be without thought and how much she gets in trouble. From her first interaction with Cinnabar that leaves parts of her body unusable, to almost allowing the Amethyst twins to get taken to the moon, she doesn't make the other gems' jobs much easier, to say the least. Yet, in every situation she gets saved from, Sensei still always forgives her. That isn't to say she's all bad. After all, she picks up winter duty where Antarcticite leaves off, and she begins to learn how to become an essential part of each battle. She learns and adapts to situations, and is full of endless curiosity. Toward the end of the anime, Foes develops into quite the battle strategist and begins to fight for the gem's benefit. But Foes also can't keep her body in one piece, with multiple limbs breaking off over the course of the series. First her legs when she follows Vendricasis into a trap in the ocean, then her arms during winter when she falls into the ice floes, and finally her head after losing focus fighting a group of Lunarians. And although her body gets replaced, she begins to resemble a completely different person after losing so many memories. Each time Foes makes a fatal mistake, you hate her because it was usually entirely her fault, and every time a new gem is taken to the moon, you can't help but think about how avoidable the situation was if Foes was out of the picture. Yet, her care for the other gems seems genuine. She wants all of them to return from the moon. Her PTSD from Antarcticite's capture is also truly genuine because she loses sleep over it. And if all of her actions are for the benefit of the gems, then you can begin to overlook her downfalls. For a character that is entirely inhuman, Ichikawa gives her enough human properties to make you sympathize. However, Foz is quick to believe anything she hears, hence why she was lured into the trap set up by Ventricasis and the Lunarians, and why she flipped her ideals on a dime as soon as she got to the moon. Whether her morals and actions are correct is a video for another day, but just know that her immature nature does not stop after Chapter 1. If you enjoyed this video, I highly recommend checking out my last review on Shimeji Simulation. This was originally going to be a much longer video, focusing on a different topic that relates to Land of the Lustrous, but since I made most of this review spoiler-free, I'm splitting it in two, and the longer, analytical video will be covering three animes with similar themes. Thank you so much for watching, leave a like, comment, or subscribe if you so desire, follow me on Twitter and Twitch, I stream when I feel like it. I'll see you guys in part 2.